This is a Much Music special presentation.
We believe in the positive healing of music. It's not like we're out there to soothe and assuage people's fears, but there is a certain comfort in wallowing in the muck, and that's where we like to stand. We like to be in that muck. We are not above those people. We're right there with them.
I used to have a band and it was really horrible, and then we broke up, and then I decided that, okay, I want to have a band like this and not like this, and then that's when I kind of formed the band.
Do you relate to some moments in the music history?
Well, 60s, but not in like a Lenny Kravitz retro way, you know, more like in a mindset, you know, that it's okay to play different types of music, but you don't have to be just a rock band, you know. I mean, the great bands like Jefferson Airplane or Led Zeppelin, I mean, they played all styles of music, and that's how we want to be, because that way the band can grow and change, and doesn't, if you decide you don't want to be you know, 100% rock band, you're not stuck. You don't have to break up the band and go form another band just to play another style of music.
It seems like a lot of people, and maybe your label included, have trouble really describing or knowing what you're all about.
See, the way we look at it is, that's great that people have trouble pinning down the band, because that's going to work for us in the long run. It may hurt us in short term, because maybe if they could pin us down now, maybe, you know, if he said such and such band and all these people like that band, then they go out and buy our record. But I mean, that's not what we're looking for. We're looking to establish our own sound and our own career. So maybe we suffer a little bit now, but eventually the word will get out, and then hopefully it'll work the way we want it to.
Yeah, we don't want to hop on a bandwagon of like the latest and newest fad of music coming out.
We're four very different people, and we really try to capture that in our music. And it's not like, well, we're four different people, but we want to sound like this. We're four different people, and we want to sound like four different people. So. Chicago has always been sort of known as a little bit of an industrial town. Did you dig up some of those influences?
Me and him both really liked all the Wax Trax kind of bands, like Ministry and people too. But, I mean, we didn't really start out as that kind of band, though. But we like all those sounds and all that kind of production. It's really cool.
But, you know, the clubs we went to, that's what they played. So you have that kind of, that sound, and it's in your head.
I pretty much still listen to Black Sabbath. That's pretty much the kind of the one downside. I'm still listening to Black Sabbath. It never changes. I never get tired of Black Sabbath.
What do you love about the genre, the form of heavy metal?
Jimmy? I'm the only one with this problem.
It's easy to play. No, it's fun. I mean, it's very visceral. It's very physical. It's very emotional. I mean, it's jazz for people who aren't that good.
I think a lot of the alternative bands, though, played heavy metal in an ironic way, and I think part of the reason we've taken a certain amount of shit is we've never played our heavy metal ironically. We meant it. We still. Recorded all these songs to make a demo, and they were just kind of sitting in the can, and we figured we might as well put a single out because we weren't going to do an album. So we just kind of approached the guy who ran the label, and we offered to just pay for the whole thing, you know, so there wouldn't even be any doubt whether or not he wanted to put it out. it's pretty much that simple. We paid for the artwork and everything. That kind of started to get the attention of Sub Pop and Caroline. And that's kind of, I mean, it was the basic impetus, but it also kind of raised the level of the band, like in our hometown, too. People we knew Sub Pop people, and some of the Sub Pop bands saw us play. It was kind of like lots of different things kind of adding up together, where it was all of a sudden, you know, nobody had ever heard of us, and then within a couple months, you know, all of a sudden all these people are talking about us to people at Sub Pop. So that was kind of a similar way at Caroline too.
I wanted to reflect all the emotions of the band, you know. A lot of people just want to hear rock music, and I think that's kind of boring, you know. You can play rock music all day, but, you know, if you go through a day, sometimes you'll be happy, sometimes you'll be sad, you know, like symbolic of life. Not like in this, you know, this God way or anything, just you know, you feel different things, and I wanted the album to make people feel different things, and that's one thing.
The album is called The Gick. Do you want to tell me why?
This is kind of, you know, came to me. It was one of those, I just, you know, sat down, and that's the first word that popped in my head. I mean, it's really that simple. A lot of people say we're about ambiguity. I don't think we're about ambiguity, but we are kind of, we do kind of veil what we're trying to say. I mean, we kind of cloak things, and you know, to call an album, you know, some long sentence or something, you know, Child of Man, Part One, or, you know, I don't know. The words seemed to really just kind of like ambiguously sum up what I was trying to say. If that makes any sense at all.
Are you like some people that think that on an album you have like two levels, the lyrical level and the musical level?
Well, for me, they're totally intertwined. I don't separate the two. That's why I didn't print my lyrics. I mean, to me, they're all tied together. It's like a painting, right? You can't just take one element out of it. It's what you see is what you get. That's kind of how I think of it.
Is there any statement behind your lyrics?
The statement is individualistic. It's think for yourself and be yourself. If anything, if anybody wants to draw anything, that's what I would draw from it. You know I love it when the music's bad. But why it feels so good, it feels so sad. I'm only happy when I'm
ready. He understands the music and he agrees pretty much with what we think should be going on.
He goes home and he like puts like a half pound of bacon in the microwave and then microwaves the bacon and then eats it. And it has beers. That's the kind of guy he is.
He's just the nicest guy in the world, and he's so intelligent and has such great ears that, you know, he's the type of guy that very few people know about him now, but he'll be the type of guy that will be making like huge, huge records in a couple years. I mean, he just finished the new Nirvana record.
People don't understand that we had worked with Butch probably, you know, 2-3 years before
right.
We ever did the Nirvana record. So,
yeah.
You know, for him to come out with a big smash like that and then for us have to get, you know, backdrafted into, you know, people saying that, it kind of bothered us.
Hey, the Grammys are for everyone. That's why, Wednesday on Much, we bring you the 1999 MTV Video Music Awards. Hosted by Chris Rock, live on stage, Backstreet Boys, Lauryn Hill, Ricky Martin, Jay-Z and DMX, TLC, Britney Spears, NSYNC, Moby, Janet Jackson, Pop Daddy, Eminem, Jennifer Lopez, Madonna, Kid Rock, Nine Inch Nails, and more. The 1999 MTV Video Music Awards, Wednesday on Much.
You know Mona Dearly?
What about her?
She's dead, why?
Everyone had a reason to kill Mona Dearly, the husband.
I was a better husband.
You don't find me attractive no more.
Of course I don't, too.
The son.
Don't touch that beer, Jeff.
I said...
The Mistress.
It's a shame about Mona Dearly.
From Destination Films comes a killer comedy that's all about taking out the trash.
What are you going to do? You're going to hit me?
Drowning Mona.
Starts Friday, March 3rd at theaters everywhere.
165 going there, 60, 60 going to 70, 70 going to 80, 80 going to 90,
90, 90, 90.
Hi, honey. Hi, honey, how was your day? Dinner smells great.
Where do you get your energy?
You ready?
For snow all year round, play Sprite Ride 365. Collect all four continents under the caps of specially marked bottles and inside cases of Sprite, and you and two friends could win a chance to board on a different continent every season.
Introducing the revolutionary Oral-B cross-action toothbrush. Its unique crisscross bristles penetrate to lift out and sweep away more plaque than any other brush. Tests prove it. The new cross-action from Oral-B.
What's the rush?
I can't miss this class.
But I could use more help.
We'll get together later.
And my school don't care if I miss the odd course. It's all about getting my certification.
First of all, at CDI, they teach you more than just how to prepare for certification. They teach you how to be ready for the world of IT. And one of those things is showing up every day and being on time.
Wow, this is pretty cool.
Studying for your MTSE exam?
Yeah.
Good luck.
To find a CDI college near you, look in the Yellow Pages directory under the heading Schools or call 1-888-485-8585.
In the stream, there was quite a lot of people, you know, wanted to buy it. It entered the Billboard chart at number 10 the first week.
Well, I think there was always kind of a buzz surrounding the band for whatever reasons. And I mean, we toured a lot, and I think it was a lot of word of mouth, even if it didn't really translate into sales all the time.
How was the shooting of today? It seems so, I don't know, natural.
It's a nightmare.
Arid and boring.
It was like being inside of an oven. It was horrible. I didn't know that the human body could stay conscious under such conditions. Only one person got heat stroke on the crew. I was really surprised.
It was 2 hours outside of LA, and it was really arid, dry, and boring. And sat around, did a lot of shots.
It looked like a cool video, fun to make.
No,
it was
not
really
fun.
A nightmare. It was
it
so
was
hot.
A That's sad.
Just a credit to our acting.
I think if I thought about the audience, I never would have written songs like 1979 at Disarm, which may strike people as ironic, but when you think of yourself in a certain way, you know, you don't think of yourself as writing a song. I never thought I would write a song like Disarm, you know, but it came to me, and then I went through this weird battle in my mind whether or not I should even put it out, because it wasn't who I thought I was. And I think a lot of those songs helped define me as a person.
Have so much emotion going through them, and it's difficult to show off that emotion without getting sappy or without overdoing it. How do you keep that balance going?
It's the best way to convey emotion that's really deep is just to be really honest with yourself. I think emotion only becomes sappy when it's contrived, you know. At first, it was really weird. I couldn't go back and listen to the record. It was, you know, it was really depressing. But I mean, after a while, you start to appreciate it for what it is. I mean, it's a very honest representation of that period of my life, and I have to accept that period of my life as being part of my life. So it's, for me to deny it is to live a lie. So every night it gets to be a cleansing thing now. It's not.
So it's part of the rehabilitation to
right,
play those songs.
I mean, now it's, you know, every night you go through an admittance of defeat and also a show of conquering that illness, you know. So it's kind of neat.
It's all I've left to do. It's right away.
There's a certain amount of change being forced upon me and then the band collectively, just you know, there's a, I mean,